Dark Secrets of the Kenyan Presidency, Chapter 1, titled The Old Man Who Stopped Drinking. The early 1950s were a time of unprecedented turmoil and violence in colonial Kenya. Yeah, colonial Kenya had always been known as a very peaceful place, yes, a place where many migrated from, mostly from Great Britain, yes, farmed very peacefully, carried on their lives very peacefully, generally had a very happy life. Yeah, it was little wonder that a part of Kenya, yeah, which is current today, was christened Happy Valley. Yeah, there was a lot of happiness in Kenya. But the 1950s disturbed all that. Yeah, there was a wind of change sweeping right across Africa, and Kenya did not remain unscathed. Indeed, this situation was very similar to what we're facing in 2017. Yeah, the natives, the locals, were just tired. They wanted change, okay? And this change could not be stopped. Now, the source of all the violence in Kenya was a ragtag militia, yeah? Guys who used homemade guns, stolen guns, pangas, machetes, called Mau Mau. The Mau Mau mainly originated in Nyeri, yeah, where there'd been a lot of land which the settlers had taken away from Africans, yes. So really what the violence was about reclaiming back what belonged to the natives. But of course the argument of the white man is that the land they owned belonged to them, yeah. They had a right to the land, they had gotten the land according to the constitution, yeah, and they legally owned the land, yeah, according to the constitution of colonial Kenya at the time. Oh boy, how things never change. Now make no mistake about it, the Mau Mau were fierce. So fierce were they that their reputation spread all over the world. Yeah, at least one very, very violent street gang on the streets of New York, United States of America, called itself the Mau Mau. Legendary South African leader Nelson Rahayola Mandela, yeah, said he received most of his inspiration to start the armed wing of the ANC, African National Congress, from Kenya and from the Mau Mau. So this group was no jokes, yeah, and they were led by one Dedan Kimathi. Yeah, Dedan Kimathi, of course, had been a soldier for the king, yes, and he had fought outside Kenya, yes, for what was called at that time the King's African Rifles. Being an African, of course, he was a low-ranking officer, okay, but he had gotten the gist of things, yes, yeah, and now he was very much able to lead an army and organize an army, ragtag militia if you want to call it, called the Mau Mau. And this Mau Mau had spread terror, yeah, right across the colony of Kenya, mainly against the Mzungu. But very interestingly, natives were also very terrified of the Mau Mau, yes. If they got an inkling that you're giving information to the enemy, if they got an inkling that you're cooperating with the enemy, they would just turn up at your homestead and massacre you and your entire family, yeah. Normally the trademark was cutting off people's heads. Now Jomo Kenyatta's State House sold us the rhetoric that it was this violent struggle that brought Uhuru, okay? And it also sold us the rhetoric that Jomo Kenyatta was right in the middle of this violent struggle. Both those statements are false. They are lies. It did not happen like that. The Mau Mau uprising, which culminated in the declaration of the state of emergency in 1952, like many other violent struggles in Kenya, did not deliver the desired results, okay? And just like any other, most of the other violent struggles, it was crushed, yeah? Maybe if I can give a more recent example of a violent struggle, in the 90s, the struggle against the dictatorial regime of President Daniel Arap Moi turned violent, yeah, at times, okay? But this violence did not yield the desired result. President Moi's state machinery crushed every uprising. However, what these violent uprisings have done is that they have raised awareness, drawn attention, and this has actually led to some results later. Yeah, so they've had something that you can call maybe an indirect impact. And so by the time the leader of the Mau Mau, Dedan Oshiuri Kimathi, faced the gallows on February 18th, 1957, the uprising had been well and truly crushed. Okay? Kimathi, of course, went to the gallows a very defeated man, very disappointed man, because he had been betrayed by one of his own. But I often wonder what he would have said if somebody had approached him and told him that just 3 years after his hanging, things would be very different in Kenya. Yeah, independence would be in the horizon. I'm certain he'd have gone to the gallows a much more cheerful man. Anyway, it is also interesting to note that Dedan Kimathi was buried in a very unmarked grave. In fact, I'd call it a hidden grave, which to date has never been found. Yeah, very early in the Kibaki administration, in 2003, great efforts were made to try and find the actual burial site of Kimathi, the idea being to exhume the remains and bury them at the Hero's Corner. Yeah, but of course the grave to this day has never been found. Very interesting. Now, the Mau Mau tactics were basically guerrilla tactics, okay? And if you look at the statistics of casualties, yeah, you get the feeling that it did not achieve much, yeah? And that actually much more harm ended up with the natives and the Mau Mau rather than the ruling colonial masters. Maybe a closer look at the death toll statistics will give us a better idea of how this Mau Mau guerrilla warfare struggle went down. In the 8 years of the uprising, only 32 European settlers were killed, yeah, and fewer than 200 British soldiers lost their lives. And then the Mau Mau also killed over 2,000 African Kenyan civilians, yeah, mostly I think traitors or whatever, you know, people they felt were not on their side or people they felt were supporting the enemy. In sharp contrast, the British killed 20,000 Mau Mau rebels in combat. Yeah, they hanged over 1,000 suspected Mau Mau supporters, and they detained over 70,000 Kikuyu civilians, yeah, including the likes of course of J.M. Kariuki. Now, these unfortunate Kenyans were put in very brutal detention camps, yeah, for very many years. Some of them just for suspicion of having provided material support to the Mau Mau. Okay? Now, it's very interesting because some researchers disagree with this figure, yeah? And they say that actually the true number of Kikuyus who were held or detained during that period was closer to 1 million. Ooh, that's a big difference. Now, the man who was to later become Kenya's first president, Jomo Kenyatta, always had a very, very frosty relationship with the Mau Mau. The main reason was that the Mau Mau considered him a collaborator. Yes, because Jomo was had made his policy very clear. He had made his stand extremely clear. Yeah, and that was to negotiate with the white man, to reconcile with the white man, find some sort of middle ground where the Africans, the natives would live a better life alongside the white man. Yeah, that was Jomo Kenyatta's stand. Jomo even published a newspaper for a while, which was called Muigwithanio, yeah, which loosely translated from Kikuyu means reconciler, yeah, reconciliation of some sort. The Mau Mau, of course, did not want any other story. They just wanted the white man off their land immediately, yeah, as simple as that. Now, the truth is, Jomo, in fact, received several death threats from the Mau Mau. Yeah, now you can imagine receiving a death threat from the Mau Mau was a very, very serious thing. I mean, these guys were not joking. Yeah, and there were many dead bodies, many decapitated bodies to prove that they were serious. Now, to many white people, the trial at Kepunguria was probably taken seriously. Yeah, but the truth is, the natives who knew the true story it was just a sham of a trial. It was ridiculous. Jomo, a member of Mau Mau, that was just so far-fetched, you could even dream about it. But fascinatingly, Jomo was not only charged for being a member of Mau Mau, he was also charged for being one of its leaders. I don't think even preposterous is the word for that. Yeah, it was just off the charts. Yeah. The chief witness in that sham of a trial was, of course, was a man known as Rosson Macharia. Yeah. Who in more recent years, I believe in the 90s, finally made a confession. Yeah. That he actually had been bribed into giving false evidence against Jomo. But if you can take another look at this, what the colonial administrators did, they just took advantage of the fact that secret movements are prone to this kind of thing. I mean, a secret movement like Mau Mau, you wouldn't know who is a member and who is not. And so it is very easy to hold somebody into court and accuse them of being a member and fabricate a little evidence here and there, and it's a done deal. So why was Jomo framed? Yeah, why did the local colonial government go to such great lengths to frame Jomo Kenyatta for a crime he didn't commit? Indeed, this hatred against Jomo by the local colonialists was so great that they quite often called him a leader unto darkness. And that statement provides an important clue. Actually, Jomo Kenyatta was known for being very traditional. Yeah, a man who very firmly believed in African traditions and customs. Yeah, one of them, which was greatly detested by the Mzungu, was female circumcision. It is actually recorded that Kenyatta took part in a public debate, yeah, in 1935 in London, yeah, on the issue of female circumcision, and he was in favor of female circumcision in that particular debate with one Louis Leakey. Yeah, Louis Leakey had a long history in Kenya. The man had even managed to learn the local Kikuyu dialect. And indeed, this debate in London must have been quite a spectacle because it was carried out in Kikuyu. Actually, those who knew just a little about Jomo Kenyatta's upbringing would not actually be surprised at this particular stance. Yeah, because actually Jomo was brought up by a very, very, very famous medicine man of that time, a seer, yeah, by the name of Magana. Yeah, so his earliest education was traditional. Yeah, so what do you expect, yeah, from a man who had had this as his early, you know, the most important years in the upbringing of any child? You get this kind of influence, it tends to stick, yeah. But when all was said and done, Jomo was not a violent man. Not at all. In fact, those who said he abhorred, he feared violence. Okay? And so clearly, he could not in 100 years be linked to the Mau Mau. But let us back up a little, yeah? Let us start right from the beginning of Jomo's life, yeah? So that we understand this man better, yeah? So that we know that we understand why it was such a frustrating and very, 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 very low period in his life for him to be actually convicted of a crime he did not commit and to be sent in jail at this particular time in his life. Yeah? So let's back up a little and find out why. Jomo was born to Muigai Wangengi and his wife Wambui at Genda Village, Gatundu Division, Kiambu. Yeah? In very, very poverty-stricken surroundings. Yeah, both his parents were, of course, illiterate, and as was the norm in those days, especially for the Kikuyu, who the whites saw as a threat, and therefore were very reluctant to accept in schools or to educate, okay? And so, because his parents were illiterate, it is difficult to know the exact year Jomo was born. But later on, he estimated that he must have been born around 1889, yeah? He was given the name Kamau at birth. Tragedy struck when Jomo was barely 7 years because his father, who was the sole breadwinner of the family, suddenly died. As was the custom in those days, the widow had to be inherited by a brother of a deceased husband or another close relative. Wambui must have been very attractive because the younger brother of the deceased did not waste any time in inheriting her. Yeah, and the union was fruitful almost immediately, because within the first few months, Wambui was already pregnant. And this was after a dry spell of 7 years or so. Yeah, remember, Jomo was the firstborn and he was around 7 years old. But sadly, there was more tragedy to follow. Wambui Jomo's mother died shortly after delivering a son. Now, for a reason that has never been made clear, Jomo's stepfather did not like him at all. Yeah, shortly after the death of the mother, yeah, it's not clear exactly when, the stepfather abandoned the two children, yeah, Jomo and his younger brother. As a young child, Jomo must have had very few options, or Kamau as he was called then, must have had very few options, and he made the decision to move to a place called Mudiga, where he had a very famous grandfather who lived there, The name of that grandfather was Kung'u wa Magana, a very revered seer who had made many predictions, and he was also a very famous medicine man. And he spent the whole day administering medicine because people visited him from very far and wide, from all over East Africa and beyond, coming for treatment because his reputation had spread quite far, And he treated them mainly with herbs. Now you can imagine, for the first time, Kamau had a stable and happy home to live in, and he was happy in life for the first time since he had been born, So you can imagine how enthusiastic he must have been running around doing errands for Kung'u wa Magana, listening carefully as he treated his patients, telling people, came in, wait, the seer is not around, he'll come at a certain time, blah, 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 and so on. But in ending this recording, I would like to draw your attention to a very dramatic event, And that is the day Kamau, Jomo that is, and his younger brother arrived at Magana's hut. It is said that when Jomo and his younger brother arrived at the door of the hut of this great seer, they were obviously very tired and they were drenched. It was raining. And it is said that the first words Kung'u wa Magana spoke, even before greetings, were the following: "You're going to be a very great leader. Leadership is in you and it is also in your seed." Something to that effect. This was a kind of prophecy over the life of Jomo. Now, as we shall see later on in this audiobook, this was to have a great impact on Jomo. Everything he did, every effort he made, suggests that he tried very hard to steer along the prophecy and help the prophecy to actually come to fruition. But he only met with frustration and more frustration. And the years passed by and Jomo grew older, and there was no sign of the prophecy coming to pass. And to make matters worse, when he was in his 60s, and this hope of this prophecy ever coming to pass dwindling by the day, instead of good things happening, Jomo was arrested on trumped up charges, and he was convicted, and he was imprisoned. Now you can imagine him sitting in that cell. Kung'u wa Magana was somebody he loved, this somebody who had brought him up, taught him a lot of things. But you can imagine him in that cell thinking about Kung'u, maybe even cast Kung'u, old man with the hopeless, useless prophecies that don't come to pass. I mean, we're human, that's what is bound to happen. So this was the situation as Jomo was jailed in Kapenguria, and as the nation of Kenya waited for a better tomorrow. Now, next we shall get into some very interesting developments, very quick developments, that actually saw Jomo change from a jailbird to a president. You'd better not miss that in the next episode of this amazing audiobook, Dark Secrets of the Kenyan Presidency. Until that next episode, this is Chris Kumekucha.